course. So today I'm going to give you the best kind of presentation there is. One, it's short, and two, all I'm going to show you is a car when we're done. Okay? So when we talked about it, I said, no, I'm not going to bring show and tell, but I do want to kind of give you a bit of an update. It's been a couple of years since I've had a chance to come down here and talk to you guys about what's going on with Rolls Royce. It's wonderful for me. I'm kind of a transplant, somewhat of a Floridian, so it's really great to come back down here. South Florida is an incredibly important market for us. I think the last time I was here, our dealer of the year had been Dallas. After I left, we quickly had named West Palm Beach our 2014 dealer of the year. And Dallas took it back for 2016. But what I can say is that in terms of the numeric importance and the significance of South Florida, it is the second most important market for Rolls Royce in North America behind California. In terms of the service and the performance that we give to our owners down here, it's second to none. Between Raymond Motor Cars or Rolls Royce Motor Cars Miami, Fort Lauderdale, Palm Beach, we have Tampa, Orlando. These are some of our best dealers in the world, not just some of our best dealers in the United States. So it's very important for us. In that tone, I don't get down here enough, is what I say. So, and then secondly, having a chance to come talk to you guys. We're a small organization. It's Elizabeth. I think everybody knows Elizabeth.
Yes.
If you don't, raise your hand. It's Elizabeth and myself. So we try to get down here, and we also, I want to be just very clear about this, we try to get the product down here as much as we possibly can. So we'll continue to do that. I won't tell you at the end, but we'll talk a little bit more about Dawn. I just kind of want to give a retrospect. I think last time I was here, I talked about the history of Rolls-Royce. I mean, we all know we're a 100-plus-year-old brand. There aren't many 100-plus-year-old brands still operating today with the same logos or same names. But we've been around for quite a while. You know, Rolls-Royce hit its heyday in the 60s, probably in the 50s, 60s, and the 70s, peaked out in the early 70s, and then just went through the 80s and the 90s on the downslide. A lot of what happened in the 90s are cars that we kind of look at. Can we take the logo off? Put another logo on there. But nevertheless, that is part of the heritage, is the decline of Rolls-Royce in the 90s. Part of our heritage, and it's a very important lesson for us. When we were purchased by the VFW Group in 1998, and we rebuilt the company, that part of the heritage was important. It told us where to go. And if you recall, when Rolls-Royce was reestablished, I remember I was in the business, obviously not with Rolls-Royce. Are they crazy building the Phantom? That's the most expensive, most exclusive motor car there is in the world. How can you start there and then try and grow your business? Of course, at that time I was working for a Japanese company, a French partner. So obviously I didn't understand it at that moment. As I look back at it now, it makes perfect sense. In a market where cars are commodities, Rolls-Royce is not a car. That's very important. That is the lesson that we take, is that we cannot turn Rolls-Royce into a commodity. Our owners don't view it as a commodity. We shouldn't view it as a commodity. It is not a car, it's a luxury item. Today, when you're commissioning a piece of art for $400,000, $500,000, $600,000, you're not picking what shade of leather and what, you know, stereo you want in your car. You're literally commissioning a Ford car. So when you put it in that perspective, starting with the Phantom made perfect sense. Now what it did is it made the most difficult business case you possibly could imagine for those that were rebuilding the brand. You have to rebuild it at a very high level and then work around that. From 2003 to about 2009, Rolls-Royce never sold more than 1,000 cars. But that was the plan. Establish a secure base of very, very loyal customers for a luxury item. And then in 2009, the picture we all recall came Ghost, quick on the heels, came 2013, came Wraith. And as we expanded out with different offerings for our own base, then we saw volume start to grow. The key learning is never chase that volume. The easiest way to chase volume is with a cheaper car, is to commoditize your product. So we don't chase that volume. We let the volume come to us, and we build the products that make our overall volume grow incrementally. Volume is not our objective. It is the byproduct of building beautiful, beautiful motor cars for people. I think that's something that I cannot stress enough. When we look today in the industry, we are not the only people that build a big piece of metal with four wheels that isn't a car. But there are very, very few other brands that do that. I'm certainly not going to name it. There are people that think they do it, they don't. So last time I was here was in 2014, we presented Ghost. And I kind of walked through that whole story in about 30 slides in about a half hour. So I thought I'd recap it for you guys today. Since we've had Ghost Series 2, at that time we were all talking vaguely about this new drop head coming. And new drop head obviously is here. I think most of you have seen it. Obviously it was coming in. And that's Dawn. Dawn is a great new start for us at Royce. Over the years, we've seen more owners come into the brand. We've also seen a new owner come into the brand. Our owners today are predominantly self-made. Back when I was talking to you about the Ghost, I said, oh, this is built for the entrepreneur. Okay? And today we have that reality. 80% of our owners are new first-generation wealth. Average wealth of a Rolls-Royce owner is over $10-15 million, up to, who's the richest man in America today. So I don't know if Bill Gates owns Rolls-Royce, I believe so, but billions and billions of dollars. We're seeing younger people come in. When we brought in Ghost, it took the average age from 65 to 55. Then with Wraith, it took it from 55 down to below 50. Now we're looking at an new owner base of about 42. We're still seeing our owner base is predominantly male, which is, I think, not surprising with an imposing motor car. But we're now seeing somewhere around 15-20% of the Dawn orders are coming from women. So for us, that's exciting. The ladies in the room aspire to play Dawn. Okay? It's really, that brings in a whole new set of opportunities for us. Because they bring in new vision, they bring in new creativity on how to bespoke their dog. And they also bring in someone that can understand the brand. You really have to get into the car, you have to drive it, you have to experience it, you have to go through the bespoke process once. And then you understand why people now have their 9th, 10th, and 12th. We have an owner taking his 10th. Rolls-Royce, new generation Rolls-Royce. In 2003, 2016, we bought 10 Rolls-Royces. We'll be delivering that company each in a few weeks. So this shift is really one thing that's extremely important about the next generation of Rolls-Royce when we look at Dawn. Now I'm going to tell you a couple of things about Dawn, but I don't want to do too much because we're going to go look at it and I'll give everybody a walk around with Dawn. I'd rather talk about it than talk at you. The first thing is Dawn, I mean, we consider it to be extremely sexy Rolls-Royce. I don't think I would refer to the Phantom as sexy. I have a lot of great adjectives to use. Sexy is not it's powerful, it's imposing, it's powerful. But Dawn gives us that sexy, approachable, it's a drop head you can drive every day. One of the adamant requirements for the designers was that it had to be a social car. When you're looking in that super, ultra, high, premium, add your modifiers on luxury car category, which really is Rolls-Royce and supercars, there is not a vehicle, there's not an offering out there that you can put four pieces in. There's a lot of beautiful convertibles in the world. Even today, even some of the mass brands, we're talking about Buick. They have a really, really attractive little convertible. Mercedes. I'm sorry, it's Matt Buick. Yes, got it. Yeah, the new Mercedes convertible is a beautiful car. All the way up to, people expect what the world's been missing, other than the phantom drophead coupe, which again was not sexy in this sense, was a real ultra four-seat car. So when you look at Dawn, you know, we're gonna put four guys in. Yeah, we'll find four guys. Okay, we're really talking about it. But is it a real four-seater? The Dawn was built to be take your partner and two other people, go out to dinner, go for a drive down to the Keys. It's meant to be driven. It's not a chauffeur's car, driver,